Well, good morning, Redeemer Fellowship, as we come together. So many good to see your beautiful faces here. Socially distanced and masked as it is, but great to see you. Stand with me as we open up in our singing, Oh Glorious Day.
One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The word became flesh and the light shined among us, his glory revealed, living he loved me, dying he saved me, and buried he carried my sins far away, rising he justified freely forever, one day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious. One day they led him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed him to die on a tree. Suffering, anguish, despised and rejected. Bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. The hands that heal nations stretched out on a tree. Took the nails for me, 'cause living he loved me, dying he saved me, and buried he carried my sins far away, rising he justified freely forever, one day he's coming, oh glorious day. Far away, rising he justified freely forever, one day he's coming, on glorious day, oh glorious day.
May be seated.
Good morning, Redeemer Fellowship. Oh, yes. Have to come up on higher ground. It's good to see your faces this morning, and I can just know that there's a lot more people out there that are being blessed by worship and by the joy of knowing Jesus Christ. And when we know Him, we have the promises of God in Him are yes. If you are feeling overwhelmed by the circumstances of life, here's one for you from Isaiah 43. Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. The rivers will not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be scorched. Isaiah 43. And we are comforted by those promises every day. Remember the old comment cards where you could write on? Well, we still have the functional equivalent of that, or even better. Because if you can't find one of those cards, you can go on our website, and on the menu there on the side is Contact. And you can go in there, and you can tell us who you are, you can make a prayer request, or you can make a comment. We invite you to do so and be a part of us. Small groups are continuing, as they have been, with a couple of important changes. Former Adventist Fellowship on Friday night is now meeting also in person. And they meet right here in the back fellowship room. And they also have Zoom capability, so people that were meeting by Zoom are not left out at all. You can join that way. And we're still together that way. Also, Sunday class, Redeemer Adults, is meeting in person right here in the side room after services, and that is also both Zoom and in person. And you can find the links. If you don't have the links, you can find it on our website. You just click on the little link there, and you can ask for the proper link to get on the Zoom. We'll be glad to have you. And you can also make your offerings online. You can go to the website, and we have been so blessed and grateful for the generosity of our members. We thank you for keeping this ministry alive and going. And you can send us a check by mail or bank check, or you can go through PayPal and through the website. If you have any questions about any of these things, just ask one of us, the elders, and we thank God for His goodness to us every day in His preservation of us and His preservation of His church that He's promised. Let's pray together. Father, Your goodness never fails. You never weary of doing good for us and showing us Your grace throughout eternity for all those who belong to You. I pray for Your grace today for Pastor Gary in his preaching of the Word and for all of us, His listeners, in Christ's name.
Well, stand with me as we sing and glory in our Redeemer.
I will glory in my Redeemer, whose priceless blood has ransomed me. Mine was the sin that drove the bitter nails and hung Him on that judgment tree. I will glory in my Redeemer, who crushed the power.
Yes, He did.
I'm
As we look at the love that the Lord has lavished on us, here's love that is vast as the ocean, love that conquered all evil, love beyond measure, and love vast as the heavens. I love that repetition of the incredible love of our Savior. So let's sing. Here is love.
Here is love, vast as the ocean, loving kindness as the flood. When the prince of life, our ransom, shed for us his precious blood. Thank you.
Hear us, Lord Jesus. Seated.
This is a Sunday when I'm always reminded of Thomas suddenly realizing who the Lord he'd followed was in its fullness and falling down with that explanation, my Lord and my God. And we have just sung about him, and then of course, the Lord goes on to say them, you're blessed because you've seen, or do you believe because you've seen and touched? Blessed are those who do not see and yet have believed, and we're among that group. and the privilege of honoring our Lord. Well, for those of you who are at home, it's great to be in your room in this particular way. And for those of us who are here, it's a privilege to be together as God's people and worshiping together. Let's just entrust the rest of our time to Him in prayer. Father, thank you for your grace to us in the Lord Jesus. Thank you for all of the things that we are able to sing with richness in our hearts about all that you have come to mean to us because you have revealed yourself fully in the person of your Son. So we look up to heaven, not with words that speak of your majestic greatness, although all those words are true, but we come before you and say simply, Father. Accepted by you into your family as sons and daughters through faith in your Son. And we thank you for the riches of your grace that you've made known to us in and through him and through your Spirit who lives within us. We come to you as a needy people. There's so much uncertainty and turmoil in the world in which we live. We thank you for the kind of lifting of some of the anxieties and the hopefulness that we're beginning to feel about the future, and yet we know there's still a long way to go, and there's some who are still suffering immensely under the pandemic and the implications and the things that have happened because of it. We know there's other parts of the world where brothers and sisters of Christ are in special need because of the ravages of the disease that are around them, and even more countries in which it is the opposition and terror of the government in which they are turning against believers. We think of our brothers and sisters in places like Myanmar, Burma, and pray that you would sustain them and strengthen them and keep them, and in many other parts of the world. For ourselves, we pray that you would keep us in love and obedience and faithfulness to you as we seek to live in ways that honor you. Enable us as a congregation to manifest your love to one another and to let our light shine out beyond ourselves so that people would see the light of the gospel in the lives of your people. Be with us now as we open your word. Show us the Lord Jesus in new and fresh ways. We would ask in Christ's name, amen. Back in about the middle of the second century in Turkey, specifically in the city of Smyrna, modern day Izmir, a man named Polycarp was the leader of the Christians. He was a man who was at that point well aged. As a matter of fact, he had been mentored early in his life by the Apostle John. He is perhaps the last eyewitness to any of the apostles. So in the middle of the second century, a wave of persecution swept that through that particular area. Christians were always suspect. They believed in one God, while the others believed in a multitude of gods. But more significantly were just the practical implications of that. What you were expected to do as a good citizen was to make offerings to the various gods. You didn't need to believe in them. You just needed to make offerings to keep them happy, because if you didn't make the gods happy, things would not go well with the city. And so it was the act of a good citizen to go to the temple and make offerings. And the emperor also was requiring worship. The Christians refused to do that. They, as a matter of fact, were known as atheists in the modern world, not because they didn't believe in God, but because they didn't believe in the gods. Well, in this wave of persecution, a notice was sent out to bring the leader of the Christians in. And they finally found Polycarp, who'd been hidden away by Christians, and they brought him into an arena in the city that was full of people that had been worked to a frenzy. There were wild animals that had brought in for their purpose, and they were shouting, "Away with the Christians! Away with the atheists!" And the governor who was supervising, saw Polycarp. He apparently was somewhat surprised that he was as old as he was, and he looked toward him and said, "If you will swear allegiance to Caesar and curse Christ, I'll let you live." And Polycarp gave the famous answer, 86 years I have served him, and he has done me no wrong. How can I blaspheme my king who saved me?" Governor pointed to wild animals and said, "I've got wild animals here." And Polycarp said, "Bring them on." And then he said, "I will throw you to them if you do not repent." Pardon me. And then he said, "If you despise the animals, I will burn you." To which Polycarp calmly replied, "Why are you waiting? Bring on whatever you want." So they took him, they tied him to a stake, they surrounded it with straw and hay so that it would go up quickly. And as they were about to touch the straw with fire, he shouted out his last words, "O Lord God Almighty, I give you thanks that you count me worthy to be numbered among your martyrs, sharing the cup of Christ and the resurrection to eternal life." The early Christians didn't just celebrate Easter as a yearly event. It was something that was right at the core of who they were and what they knew themselves to be as people. It's not an accident that they began to meet on the first day of the week, the day of resurrection and the day the church was born, on the day of Pentecost. They were weak people like all of us are, and yet they knew the reality of the resurrection. Paul writes in 2 Timothy that through the appearing of the Lord Jesus Christ, he abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. And then he goes on to say, "I have committed unto him all that I entrust." And he lived on that basis. This week, we experienced others of these mass killings that are so much an ugly blotch on our national life. And in South Carolina, a doctor and his wife, Robert and Barbara Leslie, and their two grandchildren were executed for no apparent reason by a former football player, and another man was killed as well. I was struck by this week by a statement that was released by their children who'd lost their parents and their daughter. "While there are no answers that will satisfy the questions why, we do not grieve as those without hope. Our hope is found in the promise of Jesus Christ, and we are enveloped by a peace that passes understanding." Robert Leslie was an elder in a church, and then they went on to quote his favorite hymn, "When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll." The resurrection makes a difference. Makes a difference when we face the most awful things in life, to believe that this is not meaningless and Christ is Lord, even in this time. And it makes a difference in how we think of every area of our life. So for the last 4 or 5 weeks, we've been thinking about the death conquer. And you remember we began back in the house of mourning and talked about the reality of life, how that strange statement in Ecclesiastes, that it's better to go to the house of mourning than the house of feasting, tells us something about living in a death-denying culture and our need to understand how death impacts the way we live. And then we moved to Hebrews chapter 2, and we talked about the death of Christ, about how that deals with death, how he came, as Hebrews 2, to taste death for everyone, to experience it in its full. And then the next week about how he destroyed death and the one who has the power of death, even the devil. And last week we looked at the resurrection and the reality that the Lord Jesus rose and in rising changed everything. So this morning I want to have you turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And I want to think about what it goes on to say about not simply the Lord's resurrection, but our resurrection. And then next week, we're going to look at heaven and the reality of what will our eternal life be like. Now, I want to survey part of this chapter, but we're going to focus on verses 50 to 58. So let's read those together. I tell you this, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the imperishable inherit the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed, transformed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where's your victory? O death, where's your sting? The sting of death is sin. And the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. Now, Paul is writing to a church in Greece. And the Greeks had a particular view of the body and of life. Well, when Paul in Athens in Acts chapter 17 is preaching, he mentions Jesus and the resurrection. And it says, when they heard about the resurrection of the dead, they mocked. As far as the Greek philosopher was concerned, there was one of two ways you thought about death and resurrection. For one school, resurrection was ridiculous. You died, that was the end, and there was nothing more. And so Aeschylus and those who followed him, much like modern materialists, said, death is the end and there is no more, you cease to exist. But others said, resurrection's undesirable. Following Plato, who taught that the body is the prison of the soul, Plato's belief was when you were freed of your body, you were freed into the life of the soul, into the spiritual life of all things. It wasn't all that well defined. But why would you want to keep your body? That's what you want to get rid of. And it's interesting if you compare the first group that says death is impossible to the materialists, death, resurrection is undesirable. That would be those who think that you move on to some great spiritual experience beyond, whether it's being caught up in the cycle of karma or some other experiences. And in the light of that, Paul wants to speak about the resurrection. Now, there's all kinds of things in these first 49 verses, but I want to talk about five basic truths about the resurrection that Paul wants us to understand. I'm just going to give headlines here. The first is that Paul wants them to understand the resurrection of Jesus is an undeniable fact. And so that's where he begins. The gospel is Christ died for our sins, that he was buried according to the scriptures, and that he rose, buried and he rose again the third day according to the scriptures, and he was seen. That's the central part of what he's saying. He was seen. I saw him, the disciples saw him, 500 people at once saw him, as well as others. It's a fact we're talking about, not a theory, not a speculation, not an idea. He rose, and he rose physically. I was driving past a church this week, and it was related to Easter, and they'd still lift up their sign and say, "Come and hear how love has the victory." There's all kinds of churches that are willing to say that Jesus rose into the hearts and minds of his followers. And Jesus represents love, and love is broken into the world. That's not what Christians believe. Christians don't believe Jesus lives forever. They believe Jesus rose physically. And the physical resurrection of Jesus is an undeniable fact. Secondly, he wants us to know, verses 12 to 19, it is essential for there to be any good news. And he goes on talking about what isn't true if you deny the resurrection. If you deny the resurrection, faith has no meaning, there's no forgiveness of sins, and there's no hope. Of all men, we're most to be pitied if Jesus hasn't risen. It's an empty shell. There is no good news if Jesus did not rise from the grave. Thirdly, he wants us to know in this chapter that the resurrection of Jesus inaugurates our resurrection. So listen to some of the things that he says. Verse 20. In fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who've fallen asleep, of those who've died. What he's saying, Christ was first, but there's more to come. He's the first fruits. First fruits was a Jewish feast in which you'd present the very first fruits because there was far more to come. And then he goes on to explain it. Verse 22, as in Adam, all die, in Christ all shall be made alive, each in his own order. Christ the first fruits, repeating it again. Then, at his coming, those who belong to Christ. Then comes the end when he delivers over the kingdom to God his Father after destroying every rule, every authority and power. He must reign until he's put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. So what he's saying is the resurrection of Christ inaugurates the rule of triumph, which will also always, finally lead to the resurrection of all who are God's people and the end of death. So he wants us to understand that as we come to the end. The fourth thing that he is saying in this passage is the resurrection of body of Jesus is the prototype for our bodies. In other words, if you want to know what your resurrection body is going to be like, think of Jesus. Look at verse 49, if you have your Bible open. Just as we've borne the image of the man of dust, and he's referring here to Adam, who was made of the dust of the earth, we will also bear the image of the man of heaven. So we are human beings made in the likeness of Adam, but we will be remade in the image of Christ in a physical body like his resurrection body. God's purpose is not that we live disembodied peoples, spirits floating through heaven. And all kinds of people have a view of heaven that bears no resemblance to what the Bible teaches. It is true that when we die, we go immediately into the presence of the Lord without our bodies. But that is the intermediate stage, not the ultimate stage. And so we'll come back to that more next week. The fifth thing that is said here, and there's many more things, but the fifth thing is that there is a continuity between our present bodies and our resurrection bodies. Let me just point out an illustration that Paul uses. Back in verse 36, he's describing people who are questioning, well, verse 35. Someone will say, how are the dead raised? What kind of body do they come? You foolish person, what you sow does not come to life unless it dies. And what you sow is not the body that is to be, but a bare kernel, perhaps of wheat or of some other grain. And some of you are getting into gardening now, and you're going out and getting ready, and you're planting seeds in the ground. And you plant the seed in the ground, knowing that what comes up isn't going to be another seed. You want it to be a beautiful plant of some kind, or a productive vegetable of some kind. But there's a continuity between what is planted and what is produced, even though they look very different. And there's a continuity between our present bodies and what God will ultimately do. So you'll notice in verse 42, he begins, and we'll come back to this in a moment. So it is with the resurrection of the dead. What is sown is perishable. What is raised is imperishable. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. So all of those things bring him to the place where he comes to verse 50. And in verse 50, he wants to now talk about three things. He wants to talk about a future transformation, verses 50 to 53, a future celebration, verses 54 to 57, and then our present responsibility. So, he begins in verse 50 by talking about the problem. And the problem is our bodies, as they're presently constituted, are not fit for God's eternity. Flesh and blood, which is a reference to our present mortality and the fact that we're going to die, flesh and blood can't inherit the kingdom of God. And it's talking about the kingdom in its realized form when Christ is ruling and reigning and the new heavens and the earth are in present. Our bodies don't fit heaven. And then he goes on to the perishable can't inherit the imperishable. And he emphasizes that fact to say, our present reality is, as we are, even as believers, and he's talking to Christians, we can't enter into the kingdom. So let me tell you something, he says, that has never been said before, never been revealed by God. Behold, I tell you a mystery. A mystery isn't a puzzle that you work out, written by Agatha Christie in the Bible. It is an unrevealed truth. It is something that God had never before declared. Now, the Old Testament talks, not often, but it talks about resurrection. For example, in Daniel chapter 12, it talked about what the bodies were going to be raised. But it didn't explain that, and it didn't say anything more. So Paul wants to make it clear. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. This is the verse that's put on the wall of all kinds of nurseries in churches, referring to the babies, a kind of evangelical humor. All the babies won't sleep, but they'll all need to be changed. Well, that's not what Paul is trying to convey here. We won't all die, but we will all be changed. Some will be engaged in death and then be raised, but they will not only be raised, they will be changed. There must be transformation and not simply resurrection. And the living believers who do not go through death will be transformed as well. They will become something different. So now he spells out the program. This change will take place in a moment. It's interesting for those of you who are in physics, the word atom is used here. Atom was in earlier physics thought to be a part of nature that was indivisible. And so they used the word atom. It means in a moment, smallest moment you can think of. And that's what he's saying here. Instantaneously, in the twinkling of an eye, far less time even than a wink of an eye. At the last trumpet, or the trumpet that sounds the end, when God announces the coming of the Lord that he talked about in that earlier verse that we read, and the dead will be raised imperishable. So they will be raised in their bodies, but it will not be the body that they went into the grave with, which was perishable. It will be an utterly new kind of body. And we, who are alive, Paul is thinking, will be changed. Instantaneous transformation when the Lord returns and the signal is heard, we will be changed. Now, he describes something of that body. This perishable body must put on the imperishable. This mortal body must put on immortality. Let's go back to what we read in verse 42. What is sown is perishable. What is raised is imperishable, not subject to death, not subject to disease, not subject to decay, not subject to aging, not subject to any kind of pandemics. It will be sown in weakness. And as we get older, we feel the weakness of that. Or when we're sick, we become weaker and weaker. But our resurrection bodies, our imperishable bodies, will be raised in power. They're sown a natural body. It's sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. Nothing looks weaker. Nothing looks more helpless than a dead body. But the bodies that God intends for us are bodies of glory. And then he says, if there's a natural body, it is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. Now that does not mean that it is not a physical body, because Jesus' body was a physical body. Touch me and see, he says in Luke chapter 24. Spirit does not have flesh and bones like I have. And he shows Thomas his wounds in John 20, both in his hands and in his side. So it's a real body, it's a tangible body, but it is empowered by the Spirit for all that God intends for us. It is a body that's entirely different. I die Gary Inrig 0.0, and I die in a new model, far improved. My computer was running on Mac 7 or whatever. And it was so slow. And I got a new one by God's grace. And Mac 10, and a couple of weeks ago, I was having trouble with it, or a week ago. And so I pulled up my old one and I started to power it up. And I waited and I waited and I waited. And I couldn't help but think, that's a whole lot like my present body. My body's going to grow a whole lot better than what I have as a computer. But God has something for us beyond our comprehension. There's all kinds of questions that we have. What will I look like? We'll recognize others. But the body that we will have will also be fitted with our glorified spirit, so that we are not only imperishable externally, but we will be imperishable internally. Now, Paul is writing to the Corinthians, but a number of years earlier, he'd written to the Thessalonians, interestingly, from Corinth, to explain to them what was going to happen. And he says, we don't want you to be grieved, brothers, concerning uninformed brothers, about those who've fallen asleep, your fellow believers. We don't want you to grieve as the rest who have no hope. He wasn't about them grieving, but he didn't want them to fall into hopeless grieving. If we believe that Christ died and rose again, We believe that Jesus will bring with him those who've fallen asleep in Jesus. They're with him now, and he's going to bring with them those who've fallen in Jesus. And then he goes on to say, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall be raised first. And we who are alive and remain shall in no way precede them. But we will be caught up together to meet the Lord in the air. And we will always be with the Lord. So there's the program. I think of it in terms of 4 R's. There's the return of Christ, when he comes in power and glory for his people. As I understand the New Testament, that could come at any time. And when he comes, there will be the return of Jesus. And then there will be with dead believers, and there will then be the resurrection of dead believers who will be caught up and instantly transformed into their resurrection bodies. And then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them. And we will be changed, if we're alive, instantaneously, and all of this in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, and we will forever be in the presence of the Lord. Return, resurrection, rapture, reunion, most of all with the Lord and with the rest of others. That's our hope. And it's our hope because the Lord Jesus rose again. Now, Paul says, that's the reality of what's going to be happening. In a moment, in an instant, we're going to be transformed. We're going to be transformed into bodies that are beyond our imagination, prepared for an eternity that is beyond our imagining of glory and honor and the greatness of what God has for us. And there will also be a future celebration. So notice what he says in verse 54. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, when the mortal puts on the immortal, then will come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. Now, there's a sense in which we can say some of this now. But he's talking about when the Lord Jesus returns in glory, there will be the celebration that death is fully and finally defeated. It was defeated on the cross. It was defeated at the empty tomb. It will be fully and totally destroyed at the coming of the Lord Jesus, and death and Hades will be cast into the lake of fire, and they will never again affect the creation of God in the new heavens and the new earth. And so he then goes to the book of Isaiah, chapter 25 and verse 8, and he repeats the words of that. Death is swallowed up in victory. And then he borrows the language of Hosea, chapter 13, to taunt death. This is, as it were, a taunt song. Hey, death, where's your victory? Death, where's your sting? And he's, as it were, singing the taunt song of the defeated enemies because of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And one day we will join in that. It's true that it's, on some sense, felt even when we face death. And yet I think we know there's a sting to death now. And there's a sense of loss, and we grieve, but it's not hopeless grief. And it's anticipation of the ultimate and final defeat of death. And death has a couple of partners. And so Paul describes the partners of death. The sting of death is sin. What does that mean? Sin is the stinger of death. Well, we also all know that there are some insects that have stings. And especially, I remember having a good friend who, everywhere he went, especially in the spring, had to make sure that he carried the vial of, what is it, epinephrine or whatever, I don't know the title, that because if he got a sting, he was going to die. And he always had to have that around so he could inject himself quickly. And sin is the stinger that brings on death. The wages of sin is death. And so sin is that which ultimately brings death into existence in the world. And it has a partner. And this is really quite surprising to us. The sting of death is sin. And the power of sin is the law. Now, the law is good and righteous and good. It's given by God. And yet, Paul will say, even though the law is God's good gift to us, the law brings death because it defines the nature of sin. And measured against God's law, we do not find good news. We find the news that needs to drive us to Christ for salvation. And the law, in some way, powers sin because there's something in us often when we're told this is wrong. There's something that rises to say, I don't care. As a matter of fact, if it's wrong, I'll do it. Some of you have heard me tell the stupid story of being on a preaching thing, and we were in Tacoma, Washington, and got on an elevator, and the elevator had a sign in it that I'd never seen before, and it said, do not jump in elevator. And I had never been tempted to jump in an elevator in my life, as far as I ever knew. But I read that sign, and I said, nuts to you, and I began to jump just out of, and there's something in us. And Paul is saying, we're going to know victory. We're going to know victory over sin, we're going to know victory over death, and we're going to know victory over the law, because we will have a new creation within us that keeps us constantly in the will of God, because we will be glorified. So our present, our future hope is transformation. Our future celebration is of victory. And having talked about what we're going to have victory over, in verse 57, he talks about the victor. Thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus. And it's an interesting present tense. Thanks be to God who is giving us the victory. We'll fully experience it then, but we experience it in some way now. That little note from the family of Robert and Barbara Lewis. Is Jesus giving them victory in the face of an unspeakable evil that fell to parents and children? Peace that passes understanding, because even as hard as this is to understand, it isn't outside the plan and purpose of God. So he ends. And he ends with an exhortation to how we're to live. Therefore, my beloved brothers and sisters, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. If this is true, if the resurrection of the Lord Jesus is the beginning of God's process that we're involved in that is going to result in ultimate victory. Don't be shaken by the things around you. Don't be moved off the basis you have in the gospel. Sure, they're difficult. Sure, it's threatening. Sure, the disease that you're beginning to feel in your body or in the body of your loved one, or the ailing that you're beginning to see, or the culture that is moving away so dramatically from any kind of connection with Christian roots and all of those other things, they tend to shake us. and they tend to cause us to shift. And they cause some Christians to think, we've got to accommodate. If this is causing so much trouble, let's adjust so we're on the right side of history, as that inane statement says. By the way, you can only be on the right side of history as you have someone who's writing the history. And the only author of history is God. So the only right side of history is God's side of history. But that comment bears no bearing on what I'm talking about. But what he wants us to say is, plant your feet on the resurrection of Christ, both for now and for then. Be steadfast. Be immovable. And yet he says, but don't be unmovable in the sense that you're just standing there. Abound in the work of the Lord. Work for the things that matter for eternity. Be active. Use the opportunity that the Lord has given to you to tear the good news into the lives of other people, to encourage other believers as they are struggling. Because one thing you can be sure of, your labor is not in vain in the Lord. It has purpose and it has significance. So, one of the great calls that this passage brings to me at this time is we live in shaking times and we need to be stable people, grounded in Scripture. Our confidence can't be in who's in Washington. It can't be in who's controlling various decisions. The basis of our stability is in Christ. And the reason that we have good news to share to others is because of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. This may be the week after Resurrection Sunday, but every Sunday is a Resurrection Sunday, where we plant our feet again in the truth of who Jesus is, what he's done for us, and what he is going to do. Let's pray. Father, fill our hearts with a confidence that some of the things we sang about are gloriously true. And we sung about what a glorious day it will be when all of the work of redemption is finished and we are in your presence. But we thank you now that even as we are here, your Spirit lives within us. The risen Lord intercedes for us. You, our Father, watch over us. And you have called us to live lives that honor you. Enable us to trust you and live in ways that glorify you. And even as we come around the table, remind us of the things that cannot be shaken. Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures, and he is coming again according to his promise. In Christ's name, amen. So we're going to come to the table and take these symbols that remind us of the central truths of our faith, the death of Christ, shed blood of Christ. We remember him risen from the dead, as Paul says in Timothy. And we take these and thank him and recommit ourselves repentantly before him to be steadfast, immovable, abounding in the work of the Lord, because our labor is not in vain in the Lord. We'll distribute the symbols, and as we do, we'll sing a song that just simply calls us to thank the Lord Jesus.
You're the drank the bitter cup served for me. Your love has washed away my sin. Jesus, thank you. The Father's wrath completely satisfied. Jesus, thank you. Once your enemy, now seated at your table, Jesus, thank you. And by your perfect sacrifice, I've been brought to peace. Your enemy, you've made your friend. Pouring out the riches of your glorious grace, your mercy and your kindness will go never end. Your blood has washed away my sin. Jesus, thank you. The Father's wrath completely satisfied. Jesus, thank you. Once your enemy, now seated at your table, Jesus, thank you. Lover of my soul,
Father, thank you for your Son's body given for us on the cross. Thank you for his risen body, displayed to his disciples as evidence that he had conquered death. We take this cup, this bread, in remembrance of him. And this cup, the sign of the new covenant, we take it in the Savior's name and give thanks. Amen. Well, the early Christians used to greet one another with the statement, Maranatha, O Lord, come. And Paul, having used that word, says, even so come, Lord Jesus. So let's sing a song that says that. Stand with me.
make straight a highway, a path for the Lord. Jesus is coming soon. Call back the sinner, wake up the saint. Let every nation shout of your fame. Yes, Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing. Come, oh Jesus, come. Even so, come, oh Jesus, come. There will be justice, all will be new. Your name forever, faithful and true. Jesus is come.
Father, help us as we wait to be steadfast, immovable, abounding in your work for the glory of our great Savior. Amen. Have a great week.